helps when I turn my mic on. It is Saturday. It is 2 Eastern. I was not here last week. I am here this week. Hello. How are you? Is anyone there? Am I screaming into the void? It's okay if I am, because you know what? I feel like what 2020 needs more of is screaming into the void. How is everyone doing this fine Saturday? Well, it's a fine Saturday. It's sunny. I mean, there was a bit of bad news yesterday. If you have been watching the news, Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away. Which, you know what? The last stream I was doing, we're talking about Chadwick Boseman passing away. So, you know, 2020. 2020 is the gift that keeps on giving. Ruth Bader Ginsburg was a women's rights advocate and a bastion of hope for the United States that has, you know, she gave a lot. And now she's gone. Sadly, she had cancer, pancreatic cancer, I believe. And from what I hear on the Twitterverse, the current administration, despite past protocols, is looking to replace her in the 6 weeks before election. So that's been all kind of happening and in the void in which we want to scream into. I was looking up some cool Ruth Bader Ginsburg quotes. Some inspiring Ruth Bader Ginsburg quotes. Because she was very inspiring. And there's a lot to choose from. I like the one that says there should be 9 women in the Supreme Court and how there's been 9 men in the Supreme Court. Nobody bats an eye, but she says 9 women in the Supreme Court and people are like, oh, the scandal. Women, can they rule? They can. But I particularly like this one. If you're a boy and you like teaching, you like nursing, you like to have a doll, that's okay. We should each be free to develop our own talents, whatever they may be, and not be held back by artificial barriers. Ahead of her time. Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And it also reminds me, so I have, for those who are familiar, oops, that was my phone. I want to just mute that. For those who are familiar with some of the other projects I've done, I wrote a children's book called Pragmatic Princess that I published on via Kickstarter last year. And, there we go. And I very much also took that approach of high engaged family gaming. Don't be held back. You know my book. You have my book for your daughter. Don't be held back by artificial barriers. If you're a boy and you like dolls, cool. If you're a girl and you like motorcycles, I mean, I'm going to have to just show the girl with the motorcycle because she's my daughter's favorite. She's also modeled off after Cypher of Tyr, Tanya DePass, who you may be familiar with. There she is. You are a girl who likes motorcycles, you know, do your thing. Be awesome. And you know, it goes both ways. So, how are you doing, engaged family gaming? It's nice to see you. Always wear a helmet. Safety first. I hope that's one of the lessons you talk about when you read it with your daughter. Like, if you want to ride a motorcycle, it's cool. Gotta have the helmet and the leather jacket. Also very important. EFG. I can do that. So yeah, so that's been a little rough on the news front. Guess I could start by talking a little bit about last week too. You're miserable. I know. Anything you want to talk about specifically? This is a safe space. We can talk about things. I mean, I think just generally 2020 is quite miserable. There have been some good things to happen this year. I don't want to say that nothing good has happened this year. Some good things have happened this year. We should always look for the bright spots. There's an election in North America this year. I no longer live in America. I am American. I live in Canada. But I am still very invested. Nothing in between. Yeah, just the general aesthetic of 2020 is just leaving us miserable. I'm still very invested in what's happening down there. All my family's down there and I'm from there. So that could possibly be a bright light in this year. Maybe. Mandalorian season 2 is coming. That could be a bright light in this year. Oh, the air quality in Seattle is green today. That is something to be thankful for. I have a lot of friends and colleagues in Seattle who can't breathe the air because of the wildfires. So there's a few little shiny bright nights. I wore my favorite pug shirt today. I still don't understand backwards camera. That's worth something. So yeah, I feel you. Well, I'm glad you're here, EFG, to commiserate. To commiserate, because what's the phrase? Misery likes company. It's not really, I don't want to say misery. It's a little dramatic, I guess. But not feeling good likes company to help themselves feel socially connected and mood repair and all of those psychology terms that I talk about in my YouTube videos. But yeah, so last week, I was not here on Saturday. You don't think it's dramatic today? Well, good. Some days are better than others, for sure. I did a media tour last week with the Entertainment Software Association, the ESA, who is the organization that puts age ratings on video games, physical copies of video games, the digital sales pages of video games, and everything in the Google Play Store. That was awesome. Thank you. It was kind of cool. I've never done such an extensive media tour before. If you're looking for the clip, where did I post that? I think I posted it on Twitter and Facebook. I've never done such an extensive tour before. The first day was 18 radio interviews, and the second day was 20 television interviews. And they're all back-to-back. They're scheduled. It's funny. Like, the radio interviews are a bit longer, so it's like every 7 or 8 minutes you're calling somebody else with, like, a little break in the middle. And with the television, they're only, like, 3 or 4 minutes, so it's like every 5 minutes you're calling a different station. And you send them, like, question ideas, and for the most part, they stick to them. So, really, you're spending 8 hours saying, like, the same sound bites, like, over and over and over. Every once in a while, you get a wild card, which is really interesting because some of these are live. Some are recorded and played again later. But I would say more than half of them were live, and there was one radio interview, you know. It's not like monotonous, but you get into the groove, and it was towards the end of the first day, and the lady starts the interview, you know, the introduction, and then she was like, "Video games are driving our kids crazy." And I was like, "Oh no, she's not gonna be on script. What is she gonna ask?" The interview was actually really fine, and it went really well, but it was just that initial like, "Oh, okay." I just want to talk about, you know, games are not destroying a generation and age ratings are important. But when I was doing it, I had a really good time working with Pat Vance, who is the president of the ESRB. She's absolutely wonderful and lovely. And she was, obviously, her bit was talking about the age ratings that they do over there at the ESRB. And there are three elements to them. And I feel like I have her bit memorized because I heard it so many times. And I knew this stuff, but I didn't know it. I knew it, but I didn't know it. I don't know. So there's age ratings, right, which tell you the age, M for mature, E for everyone. I also learned E for everyone is their largest rating category and has been from the very beginning. And M for mature games, I think she said, make up only 28%, somewhere in that ballpark, of all the ratings that they did last year. So there's that. Then there's content labels, which is what I always tell parents to look at specifically, because that'll tell you why a game is rated a certain way. So it'll say M for mature, but the content label will be like violence, suggestive language, you know, whatever it is that gave it that rating. And then there's interactive elements, which is tells you, can you buy in-game purchases? Are you linked to the internet? Is your personal information shared? That stat does surprise me. And it did also surprise everyone in the interviews that M for mature was such a small proportion. I mean, it's only like a third, less than a third, because it gets all the attention, right? And I guess I didn't really, I mean, I played some E for Everyone games. I always liked Nintendo games. Those are all generally E for Everyone. But I have to say, like, in my PlayStation repertoire, not too many E for Everyone. I mean, Ratchet and Clank, surely that's an E. But yeah, it did surprise me. Yeah. Sports games, that's a good point. I don't play those, so I didn't think about that. Yeah, sports games. There's a lot of racing games or a lot of Gran Turismo. They still make those, right? Yeah, they help with the numbers, but it is interesting that that's always been their largest category. So there's your tidbit of the day. Also, the interactive elements thing, if you're a parent out there, very important. They also said on the ESRB website, oh yeah, two more things. On the ESRB website, there's actually blurbs that are written also. So if you really want to get in depth about what a game's about, or it even says there'd be like examples. So if the content label said suggestive language, there'd be examples in the little blurb on the ESRB website. You can look up a game by title. It'll say like, this is what we mean. This is the suggestive language. So it's really in depth. She also talks about a website, parentaltools.com, which will tell you how to set up parental controls on your device, like step by step, regardless of what device you're trying to set it up on. So that was all like really good information. You include those blurbs in your reviews. Well, very good. I'm glad to hear it. And I'm sure that ESRB is glad to hear it too. Very interesting, because I was talking to her about Twitch and streaming, and I was saying how I used to watch Twitch back in the olden days before it was acquired by, I don't know who was acquired by, Amazon, Google. Before it was acquired and became like super popular, I would watch it. I'd watch Dat Mods. He still streams. Hi, Mods. Still a fan. I would watch him play games, mostly Diablo 3, but also play new games that I wanted to play but wasn't sure if I wanted to purchase them yet. And I really used Twitch. That was like my primary use for Twitch, was to see people play games, get a sense of the gameplay, see if it looked fun before I went and spent 50, 60, 80 bucks on it. Now my primary use of Twitch is probably watching talk show based things like anxiety and things like that. People more just people chatting and having guests on gamer doc than gaming play. Though, you know, Dat Mods every once in a while, he does it late at night. He's so funny. And it's funny too, watching, speaking of mods, he doesn't know me. Maybe he does. I don't know. Watching how it's progressed over time, you know, when Twitch was like a thing that I felt was relatively underground before it had its own app on my TV, to now like how the streaming setups have changed. And for a streamer that has like held on this whole time, it's quite interesting to see how that's occurred and changed. I went on a bit of a tangent. You're not streaming too much, EFG. I see you every once in a while go live on Facebook, but maybe you should get into doing it on Twitch instead. So yes, what else has happened? My closet is being renovated still. I don't know if you guys heard me complain. I complain about it on my main Twitter a lot, because it's been going on for like 6 months. So I was lucky I was even able to find this shirt today. I don't know if any of you guys are doing home renovations. I know this is not related to Psychgeist, sorry, but it's really sticking in the back of my mind because it's an ongoing project. I hate ongoing projects that are not finished, because it's always in the back of my mind that no matter what else I'm doing, I have to do that. So it has me a little distracted. Look at that. It's almost as if I knew, but I didn't. So that's very exciting. That's very exciting. Welcome to the Twitch community. Everyone has been welcoming and lovely so far. That's exciting. I'm excited for you. And I think it's important to expand your message. We're gonna move on to more gaming things. It's a gaming show. I got a little distracted by things. Let's talk. All right, EFG, which one are you getting? There's some big announcements. I know you and I are equally hyped for Final Fantasy. I would play the trailer here, but I don't know how to get sound to go through the things, because as you know, I barely know how to make my face come through this thing, so not gonna do that. But if you Google Final Fantasy 16 trailer, your mind will. You're getting both. You're not a regular consumer of Twitch or a regular consumer of game consoles. Oh, you mean, oh, you're saying you're not a regular consumer because you're EFG. Yeah, so you're getting both. I am definitely not getting both. So if need all three, I mean all three. We mean all three. The third thing. Did Nintendo talk about a thing? I didn't hear Nintendo talk about a thing. What? There was a new Nintendo thing?
Now.
Okay, I was like, how did I miss that news? Take away my cool person card now. Okay. Yes, well, I do have a Switch. I do have a Switch. Nintendo consoles, generally speaking, have always been my favorite. And PlayStation consoles have always been the one I buy to play Final Fantasy before Final Fantasy was cross-platform. Because it was a long time before it was cross-platform. Yeah, that is what I am getting. No question. I'm very, very excited about Final Fantasy 16. Ah, it's going to be so good. What are the other exclusives that you are excited about? What else did I see announced? I don't know if I even paid attention to anything else. I saw there's a new God of War game. I saw the new Harry Potter game. There's a new Assassin's Creed, I think. I had to say, I was like in and out of the news. I was just like, oh, racing chocobos. Okay, I'm done. That's all I need to know. Yes. So I talked to my brother and he called me yesterday and he's like, what are you getting? And I was like, PlayStation. It's not even a debate. And he was like, oh, well, I have the Xbox Game Pass. I've never owned an Xbox. I have always been a PlayStation exclusive. Never owned an Xbox. And again, it was mostly driven by my desire to play Final Fantasy. And then anything else I could have possibly wanted to play, with the exception, I guess, of Halo, but that's not really my jam. Like, I never really wanted to play that. And my husband, who was my boyfriend all through college, also, we were just like, eh, we can live without it. Oh, the Spider-Man! The Spider-Man game looks amazing. Team Xbox! Hello, Ethan. Yes, the Game Pass, you know, maybe if I had more time to actually try new games. I know a few weeks ago I was telling you all that I started playing the Final Fantasy VII Remake, and I have, but I don't think I've played it in like a month. Again, closet renovations taking a lot of that time. But I see the value in the Xbox Game Pass. There's no PlayStation equivalent. That's really strange. I feel like, isn't there like a, like my husband definitely gets like, but I think it's like one game a month. I don't know if that's the same, like one game a month that he gets to play. No, there's no equivalent. Well, Sony, you should get on that because that's clearly drawing people to Team Xbox. And also the PlayStation is way prettier. Come on. Yeah. And I feel like that's always been the case, Ethan. Like just historically that the PlayStation has better games and better lineups. PlayStation Plus, that's what he has. Yeah, it's not the same. And I don't think he gets to pick what games. I don't know if you get to pick the games with the Xbox Game Pass, but Rex, my husband, doesn't get to pick the games. He just like, because I saw some games on our list. I'm like, what are these? And like, what are these random like horror games that are down? He's like, oh, it's just whatever. Yeah, they're given to you. Yeah. That is a consideration. I mean, I guess also too for you, EFG, if you are a content creator, it's good to have access to all these different games. I know Kelly Dunlap, who is a good friend of mine. She also streams. She's all about the Game Pass. Yeah, so I understand. We all know you're not normal in more ways than one. All the good ways. Normal is boring. But yeah, that'd be exciting. I'm sure your kids are excited that you're getting both. That was a joke. We're friends. I know him in real life. I can say that. I'm not being mean. I promise. Frenzies. I'll move on to the science portion now. Now that I have slightly offended my BFF. You know, I also, for Engage Family Gaming, I used to do a lot of content for them. I haven't in a while, but maybe now that you're on Twitch, we can work something out. I'm going to get you here too for 20 questions. One of these days I'll get you here for 20 questions. So, I want to go to the science portion of the stream. I have a couple of things I'd like to talk about. Oh, good. I mean, I'd be happy to have you. I'm curious whether I should do new 10 things I want to know about you questions for the new year, or if I should just wait. I think I'll wait for a full year. You're sweet. Time is funny in the time of COVID. I feel like I should have more time. And I feel like in some ways I do. But I also feel like I have less time. Maybe it's because I'm filling it with more things. It's really just so strange. You should do some of the same questions, then mix them up. Okay, so with 20 questions, the first 10 are always the same. And then I have the 100 in the container. But I'm thinking I should switch out. Or maybe I should add more. Maybe I won't even take them out. Maybe I'll just add more than 100 in the container. Maybe let's add like another 25 or something. Oh, I'm definitely going to leave the first 10. The first 10 are important, I think. I like to think of it as a career day in game studies. If you haven't seen any of my 20 questions episodes, I have them once a month. Thank you. And then the guests, I've had Dr. B, the clinical director of Take This. I've had Gamer Doc, content creator, and esports medical doctor next month. I don't want to spoil it. I have somebody else, and then I have a couple months ahead planned. And I always ask the same 10 questions because I think a lot of times I would go to PAX and I would do these panels about how to have a career in games, and they were always full. And with those panels, what we would do is we would just talk for like 15 minutes and say what we did, and we'd have, you know, someone from the industry, and we'd have like me, and then we'd have like a geek therapist, and we'd have a little bit of a smattering, a community manager. And then we'd be like, what questions do you have about how to get into the industry? And the line, it would last the entire hour, and there would still be people waiting in the line when the hour was up. So I thought, like, going off that idea, what my 20 questions I do once a month is I bring somebody from the general field of game studies, whether they're a content creator or a clinical director of a nonprofit related to games or whatever it might be. And the first 10 questions are about, like, how did you get into the field? What's your average day like? What's a big misconception about what you do? What's your advice to give to somebody who wants to do it? And then the second 10 questions are drawn from a tin, and I call that section 10 things we want to know about you. And they're like super random, like what's your favorite sandwich, or are you a Mario or a Luigi? You know, those kinds of things. And it's been really fun. The video with Dr. B was great. It was. He talked about his hat collection. He talked about his music tastes. He's generally a wonderful human. But yeah. Well, I guess I'll just tell you. So next month, we're going to have Jim O'Hagan, who is an esports coach for teenagers. He's also an educator, and he's also a PhD student. So there's a lot to cover there. We're going to see him in October. And in November, we're going to have Victoria Tran, who's a community manager for Kit Fox Games. And I like to say TikTok sensational star. Her TikToks are the bright light of my 2020. The end of 2020, when we list the 5 things we're grateful for, Victoria Tran's TikToks, they're going to be in that 5. They're going to be in that 5. She's wonderful. So maybe we'll get you, EFG, to round out the year. Maybe we'll get you for December. I'm talking to Victoria in November. In November. The date is scheduled, but I don't know it offhand, but it will be announced ahead of time. Tell her not to forget the shield. Well, you could tell her because you can be here. I will try to remember that. Or you could come and also tell her that. I love Victoria. If you don't know her, you guys should follow her on Twitter because she's the best. I'd have more weight if I do it. Okay. I will tell her. Don't forget the shield. Okay. That one is going to be good. So some interesting things happened this week that I'm not totally at liberty to discuss, but it was, I had an interesting professional conversation, one of a nature that I have never encountered before, which was, how do I say this in a delicate way? I was being asked to come as an expert about games and on a panel, but was also asked basically to withhold my expertise and knowledge if it conflicted with something that someone else on the panel was saying, because I had some concerns about the other panelists being not qualified experts. Anyway, in the conversation in which I eventually led to, I will not be on this panel because if I can't share my level of expertise or make sure that things are scientifically accurate, it's not the panel for me. In that conversation, there was a lot of discussion about video game addiction and video game violence. And the people I were talking to who are not game studies experts were telling me in a very forceful way that most scholars agree that there's not enough evidence to suggest that violent video game play there's not enough evidence to say violent video game play does not contribute to real world violent behavior. Patently false. I was also told that most scholars agree the video game addiction classification from the WHO is a good, generally just like a good thing. And we should just like roll with that. Also not true. So I had a hard time in this conversation maintaining my cool. But I digress. So the reason I talk about this is because when I responded and said I don't feel comfortable being on this panel if I can't share my level of expertise in an accurate way, I feel like you just want me to smile and nod when people say factually incorrect things, and that's not cool. I'm not going to be complicit with that. I linked this study, which is, how old is this? 2015. But it's a really good study, and it surveyed game studies scholars on their perspectives on the prevalent debates in the field. Now, the difference between someone on the other end saying, I think most scholars agree that there's not enough evidence to say violent video game play contributes to aggression, first of all, is patently, it's just not true, because there's lots of evidence that has indicated no links with real world violent behavior, but also was just something this person was taking out of the air, whereas this study actually asked scholars in the field who are aware of the literature, who have a knowledge of what we know in the research community, what their opinion is on what the conclusions they draw from that. So I wanted to share this with you because it's just a really good study. I don't know why I wasn't a part of it. Oh, I guess because it was 2015. So Torsten Quant, the first author, was my postdoc supervisor, best boss I ever had, wonderful scientist. Generally great. Jan van Looy runs the game lab in Ghent, not anymore. He used to run the game lab in Ghent, Belgium, which is also one of the world leading game labs. Torsten ran the game lab in the University of Münster, which at the time in 2015 was still running the SofaGo project, which was the largest EU funded project on games to date. Jens was another one of Torsten's postdocs, as was Malta. James Ivory's at the University of Virginia Tech. He's at Virginia Tech. Sorry, James. Also runs a great games lab there. Mia Consalvo is the former president of DIGRA, runs the game lab in Concordia, and Franz Myra runs the game lab at the University of Tampere in Finland. He's also one of the founding fathers of the Digital Games Research Association, DIGRA. These are all heavy hitters, okay? This is a stellar cast of authors. So this isn't just some like random thing I found under a rock. I took a lot of breath. So they're just talking about, you know, game studies. I hate that this is sideways. Game studies as a discipline. They talk about, you know, the different journals in the field. I think the main thing I want to show you is also going to be sideways, and that's annoying. We're going to have to learn to read sideways. So participants were recruited through ICA. ICA is the International Communication Association. They have a large game studies division. So there were students, there were designers, they excluded students and designers, they just wanted researchers. So there's 483, they looked at 483 scholars. This is also a good, how does Rachel read research articles? She skips it. Usually when I have read this multiple times, usually I go right to methods. Let's get down to the meat. We'll go back to the literature if I find the methods and the results interesting. So then they had, you know, they asked them questions and everything was on a 1 to 5. They asked about gaming effects, if they're beneficial, if they have harmful effects. Okay. So this is also interesting. So these are the different fields that the scholars were in. I'm in psychology, so that's here. And that's obviously one of the many fields that a game studies scholar can be in, but we also have sociology, arts, humanities. It's a lot in humanities. I would say like a good proportion of the colleagues that I have would fall under humanities and media studies and communication. So Torsten at the University of Münster is a communication department. design, psychology, engineering, computer science, and educational sciences. It'd be interesting to see how if this was done again today, because I feel like now game studies is becoming more multidisciplinary, where people are kind of like cross department. So we'll see. Okay, so academic disciplines of researchers. This is what I want to say. Look at right here. Sideways. I'm gonna download it and see if in no. I want to open it with like something I can rotate it in. What can I rotate it in? Preview, probably, right? Okay. Not that one. Okay. View. No. Stop. Get out of here. View. Can I rotate this?
Surely. Tools. Rotate. That was the wrong way.
Now we're just going to go in a circle. Ha ha. Okay. Look at that. The power of trial and error. Okay. Much better. Whew. Do you still have the massive database of studies? I do have the massive database of studies on my website. I'll just talk about it now because I'll get distracted. If you go to rcohort.com/ludodemia, L-U-D-O-D-E-M-I-A, for those who aren't familiar, I think that's the link. Oof. Let me just double check and make sure that's the actual link. No, it's not. Oh, I suck. I'll give you the actual, it's resources/ludodemia. I have a database of studies. To be fair, it has not been updated in a while. But if you're looking for studies by subject, I mean, the stuff in there is still valuable and it's a good place to start, but it's not as up to date as one with all endless time, like Rachel with no children had when I originally made that database. Yeah, absolutely. It's still a good resource. So here are the outcomes. So remember, this is on 1 to 5 scale. So digital games can have beneficial effects, oh, you know, 4.34 out of 5 on average out of 500 people. So that's a pretty strong consensus. Yeah, you're welcome. That digital games can have beneficial effects, which we do know from the research, which makes sense because these are researchers answering these questions. So when you first hear people in the media saying games are a waste of time and then the beneficial effects there, that question is already, well, actually in the scientific community, there is a consensus that they do. The potential of using digital games in education is promising. There's a 4 out of 5. The potential of using digital games in health is promising. Got 4.04. Digital games can have harmful effects on their users. 3.19. So we're not saying as a community that it's impossible for games to have adverse effects. That would be ridiculous. Of course, some people use games problematically and have adverse effects in their life. There is zero question that that happens. Excuse me. Now, this is the part that got particularly relevant to that discussion that I had earlier in the week. Addiction effects of digital games are a problem for society. 2.61. That is right in the middle. And this was 5 years ago. I imagine if you ask this question now, I would predict the number would be less. But it's also kind of a nuanced question because the question is, addiction effects of digital games are a problem for society. I would like to see the question, do you think games are the root of video game addiction? I wrote this article, I gotta get another link. I should have these links ahead of time. I'm sorry. I wrote this article on Medium a few weeks ago called, Is Video Game Addiction Still a Thing in the Era of COVID-19? In this article, and I brought this up in the conversation I had earlier this week, I talk about how there's a lot of research that points to, that games, of course, are problematic and people use them problematically and they have detrimental effects. But researchers believe that these effects or the use of games in this particular way is a coping strategy for something else underlying. If it's depression or a self-regulatory problem or ADHD, or if there's something else driving using the games in a way that leads to maladaptive effects. Do we know this for certain? No, we need more research. But if you look at the research, and I outline it in that particular article, it makes a case for that versus games in and of themselves being the problem. Because in terms of behavioral addictions, the only other behavioral addiction in the, recognized by the American Psychiatric Association at the moment is gambling addiction. And gaming is in the back as something that requires future research. Now, the World Health Organization went ahead and said, we're going to include internet gaming disorder in the ICD-11. Now, they haven't published any data on why they have decided to include this in the ICD-11. It was met with pushback from scholars in the community. There's a famous open scholar letter. I think I also linked that in the Medium article. Signed by dozens of scholars in the field, several of the people who wrote this article, as saying, you know, this seems to be jumping the gun. We don't have enough research. And it matters because treatment programs will be designed based on the idea that the game is the source of the problem versus something else. So if obsessive compulsive disorder or if executive functioning disorders are spurning the problem, the treatment needs to be that, not the games. And that's really where the crux of the argument is. So that was a tangent. It's impact on personal bias. You know, so many things. So this is not, most scholars agree, right? This is middle of the road. This is like a 50-50 split. And again, I think, you know, this was in 2015, which data collected might have been 2014. I'd be surprised if the results haven't changed. And then we have digital games are an aggression, right? And this is even lower, 2.18. So the difference between this, so when I was having these conversations with these people this week, it started with addiction and I was like, well, I don't know. Can't really get on board. Then it progressed into aggression and violence. And I was like, really can't get on board with this because of all the research we've done in game studies. We've been studying games for half a decade. You know, of all the studies we've done, the most by far has looked at the impact of violent video games. No question. That is the biggest chunk of research that we have. We know a lot about violent video games and their effects. And as you can see, scholars generally do not endorse this idea that digital games' effects on aggression behavior are a problem for society. And that's because we see short-term increases in laboratory settings that are measured somewhat dubiously, and we see zero relationships with violent crime and behaviors. I digress. Moving on. Attitude towards beneficial effects of digital games. So generally, they have a good attitude towards that. And harmful effects and negative. And that's because we know what the research says. And the research has found lots of beneficial effects. And of course, there are some adverse effects, but they're generally fueled by moral panic, which brings up this week's new YouTube video that I posted, which was about games and moral panic. And if you haven't seen it yet, I'm gonna get another link for you. If you haven't seen it yet, I'm quite proud of that one. And it's about the history of the moral panic in video games. And it's a good watch. So here's something for you to watch later. So yeah, so this is a really good study. I really enjoyed it. They also have, you know, demographic kind of stuff. Like, do you consider yourself a gamer and that sort of thing? But you figured that's where I was going. That is not where I was going. Just kind of landed there. That worked out really well. That worked out really well. You know, I was wearing this shirt this morning and I saw my neighbor's children across the street. I have a pug. I have a dog pug. And they were like, do all your clothes have pugs? And I was like, no, but all my best clothes have pugs. They always see me in like a pug scarf or like this shirt. Like, what can I say? I think like pug mommies are special mommies and they just love their pugs. That's not where I was going. But the video Moral Panic, I think it's quite good. I just do. Some videos are better than others. I think that one's quite good. And we are reaching the end of the month, which means this Wednesday is a new state of the research. And this Wednesday, it's going to be the one on toxicity and dark participation, which I'm very, 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 very excited to share with everyone. When I recorded it, I must have recorded it over a month ago. And I was like, I gotta wait till the end of September before I can release that one, because everything has to go on schedule. So I've been really waiting to release that one. And now it will be released on Wednesday. So if you don't follow the YouTube channel, you should. And it will be there on Wednesday afternoon. Oh my goodness. I've been doing a lot of talking. I need a little bit more tea and a little bit more. My caffeine is coming. This mug has been to the dishwasher a couple too many times. You know, this mug, we'll do a little sidebar. This mug came from my Reddit Secret Santa. Does anybody else do Reddit Secret Santa? I do it every year and I get the best gifts. Every year I always have such a good Secret Santa. I had this mug. What else did I get? I got a pug picture in a frame that was like the pugs dressed like Sergeant Peppers because I'm a huge Beatles fan. I've gotten lots of really good things from Reddit Secret Santa. And I know a lot of celebrities do it and you see like the crazy packages that they send every year. But it's just something fun and novel to do at Christmas time. I do it every year. It's great. Highly recommend if you don't do it. But anywho, what else do you guys want to talk about? It is end of September, which means fall is here. It's cold, but you know, I do live in Canada, so I guess that comes with the territory. At least for now, it is not snowing. It is sunny and cold. Doing homeschooling, which also takes up a significant proportion of my time. I'm sure the other parents out there, maybe your schools are open. I don't know, here as well. I'm in Ontario. The COVID cases have been steadily increasing. So even though I've been doing online school, I haven't sent my kids to school. I had hope that one day I would be able to send them to school, but I'm pretty sure the schools are going to close in the next couple weeks. I have a feeling. School is hybrid. And digital school is great because I don't want to get sick, right? I don't want to get sick. I want my kids to be safe. I want to be safe. But that also means my kids are just home. All the time. So it's interesting. It's not looking good for them staying open. Yeah, it's not looking good here. They just reduced the size of outdoor and indoor events. Although to be fair, I haven't done any of those. I've done some outdoor stuff. During the summer I did because none of the kids were in school, so I had my social bubble and we would do outdoor things. But since my bubble's kids have since gone back to school, I have not been doing anything just because, you know, I don't want to risk it. But yeah, it looks like the schools are going to close. It's hard. It's hard. I hope that there's a solution somewhere in our future. Sorry. That's a bit of a downer, but you know what? It's part of 2020. COVID and elections and not enough caffeine. That's for sure. That's for sure. Oh, goodness gracious. Well, I do have one more study I could talk about, which I do have open here on my screen if we're interested. We have 20 minutes. I don't know if I have anything else to talk about, so maybe I'll just go into that. I have been, actually, you know what I'm going to talk about instead? I'm going to talk about something else instead. There is an event upcoming. Let me open it on my computer. We can talk about the other study. The other study I was going to talk about is I've been editing a special issue. I've talked about it before on digital games and well-being for Frontiers in Psychology. And the good thing about Frontiers in Psychology is that it is open science. So you can see the full article without going through a paywall, which is great. And so I'm trying to highlight the articles that are being published in there because I think it's fantastic that everyone can access them and you don't need like a library or a university affiliation to see them. And there was a new article published this week by Reagan Mandrick and colleagues called How Passion for Playing World of Warcraft Predicts In-Game Social Capital, Loneliness, and Well-Being. So I might save that gem for next week. And instead, I'm going to talk to you guys about this. The International Game Summit on Mental Health Awareness. The first International Game Summit on Mental Health Awareness happened last year in Toronto. Take this. So, the organization, that I work for, is one of the organizers of the event. It went really well last year. We were talking about mental health issues in the industry and just around games generally, and the schedule and the program for this year's TIGS, was just announced this week. It's, of course, digital. We're not going to be traveling to Toronto. But it's going to be a fantastic program. Let's see if it's up here. Aha! So we can see some of the people. Here, that you have Chris Charla and Mike Wilson, Melita Moore. She is on the esports, the Global Esports Federation board, which are the people who are responsible for coordinating esports and the Olympic Committee, which is quite cool. Emily Grace Buck, who is a game designer. We have some streamers. We have Renee Gittens, who is the president of the IGDA, the International Game Developers Association. We have Platinum Paragon. We have Dr. Mark Klein, who is the first clinical director of Take This. Celia Hodent, who is a game designer and has several wonderful books. If you haven't read them and you're interested in game design stuff, her books are wonderful. Doris Rush, another game designer. So Genesee Gray and Victoria Tran. We have some community managers. So it's going to be really, really great. And I, of course, I just wanted to share this with you in case you guys are interested in checking it out and seeing the content. And I think it's in October. I should know because I have to be there. October 7th and 8th on Zoom and Twitch. Have you guys been checking out PAX Online? That has been happening also. That's something else. I'm talking about a lot of online conferences. You know, there's been a lot of online conferences and some are better than others, for sure. PAX Online, I think has been generally really good. Really good. I've seen a lot of good content, coming through there. There was, you know, some D&D games. I know that Dr. B did a couple D&D games. I did a panel on the power of social community. And how not every corner of the internet is a cesspool for hate. There are like little gems and pockets. And I had Tanya DePass and Anxiety and Tanzi on that panel. And it was wonderful. We did a Psychology of Final Fantasy panel. And I think it's still going on until tomorrow. I mean, it's 9 days, 24-hour content. If you haven't checked it out, there's 3 channels on Twitch. There's PAX, just PAX, and then PAX 2 and PAX 3. And it's just constant panels and game demos. And, like, the little commercials even in between the panels are really good. There was a game called Unpacking? I want to say is an indie game where you just, like, unpack things out of a box. Oh, my gosh. Talk about the thing you need for 2020. It's, like, it hangs your shirt up all nice and neat. You put the things on the bookshelf and it organizes them. That's the kind of thing I need to have order in my life. It looked quite good. So if you haven't seen any of the PAX content, you still have today and possibly tomorrow. I'm not sure exactly when it ends, but it's definitely still on today because I'm still getting notifications for it. And then Geek Jeopardy might be tonight as well on PAX, hosted by geeks like us. So there's lots of fun. Maybe that was last night. I'm losing track of time. I can't be the only one losing track of time. It's like, it's the end of September. Year's almost over. Election day's coming. If you're in America, you need to vote. So all the fun things. Think about TIGS. Think about coming to check out TIGS. I'll be there, of course. It'll be a lot of good questions about mental health and the industry and how to take care of yourself and personal experience stories and that sort of thing. So yeah, there we are. You wouldn't miss it for the world. Thanks. Thanks. Hey, Mr. Gal, high five. Gamer Doc and Ceridactyl, the two people pictured in those emojis, will also be at TIGS on separate panels. So yeah, so I was, as I mentioned earlier in today's stream, I was doing the ESRB media tour. And I just love the fact that I had myself positioned in such a way, I don't know where I was, I must have been like over here, where my Moogle and my clinical role poster were in like every shot. So in news stations and living rooms across North America, my D&D campaign poster made its television debut, which I just find just makes me giggle. I just find that to be quite funny. It's the small things in life. I'm sure Randall found it to be quite nice too. Randall Hampton, who drew that art. But yeah, speaking of D&D, our D&D campaign returns. I return to our D&D campaign on Monday. Clinical Role is at 9 Eastern on Geeks Like Us. It's we're a bunch of geeky therapists. I'm not a therapist. Geeky therapist and me play D&D. And it's fun, and you can see me slowly decline into greater extreme tiredness as the night goes on, because it starts at 9 p.m. my time, and it ends at midnight my time, which is like way later than I stay up ever, because I have two small children. And as the night goes on, my teacups get bigger and my eyes get droopier. So that's fun if you want to come for that. And actually, the campaign is ending this year, so there's not too many games left if you want to check that out. But yes. What are you excited about, Mr. Gao? Are you getting a new Xbox or a new PlayStation? Or excited for Final Fantasy 16? What else did we talk about? Spider-Man. God of War. There were a lot of announcements that happened this week that people have been talking about. The Harry Potter game, that has been controversial. It started kind of on a level of excitement, but has since not. But yeah, there's a lot of new things. I wish I just had, clones so I could play all the things all the time. But I mean, I'll live through you, EFG. I'll live vicariously through you and your experiences with your Xbox and your PlayStation. Another Xbox. Xbox is winning the chat. Everybody in chat. I mean, EFG's getting both, but he said if you only had to pick one, it would have been the Xbox. Xbox is winning the chat. Well, I'm in the minority here. I'll just be alone with my PlayStation playing Final Fantasy. Although, I guess all Final Fantasies are cross-platform now, so. Wah, wah, that doesn't even make me special anymore. Ah, well. So, if I've hit peak 2020, you'll be there with me, that's true. But you'll have both. You'll be in both groups. I hit peak 2020 this week. Did I take a picture? I think I did. I think I took a picture on my phone. I'm going to share it with you. I have reached my limit. Is this where I have the picture? Yes. I have ordered a 5-pound bag of gummy bears. That is where I am now in my life, is a 5-pound bag of gummy bears. And they're delicious. I feel like they're going to give me stomach problems. I don't know. Maybe if I eat them all. That's all I have to get me through. To get me through these days. EFG, can I have $5? Mr. Gao's good for it. You can give him $5. I can vouch for him. Although I'm pretty sure he means $500 so he can get both consoles. That might be a harder sell, Mr. Gao. I'm not sure you're going to get that. Oh, goodness gracious. No. You miss all the shots you don't take. Nah, you had to try. All right, well, I guess that's all for me today. I feel very lethargic, but I'm happy that we had our chat today. I missed you guys last week. I was just so tired of talking after all of those interviews. I just could not imagine talking anymore. But I'll be back next week. Let me see if next week is the week that we're going to have James O'Hagan or not. No, because there's another week of September. Because what is time? Cool. 2 weeks from now, we'll have Jim. So I'll see you next week. We'll talk about that World of Warcraft study. And we'll see how everybody's doing. Be excellent to each other. Cite your sources. Check out this week's YouTube video. The one on toxicity is coming next week. It's going to be good. Yes, we're talking about wild studies next week. So, bye, everybody.